Good morning and welcome again to Spirit and New Ministries. Thank God for another day of worship. We can come together and lift up the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I'd like to begin this morning by calling your attention to Psalm 145, the 145th Psalm, verses 1 through 5. And it reads from the King James Version, I will extol thee, my God, O King, and I will bless thy name forever and ever. Every day I will bless thee, and I will praise thy name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise thy works to another, and shall declare thy mighty acts. I will speak of the glorious honor of thy majesty and of thy wondrous works. We serve an awesome God, great and greatly to be praised is he. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come today and we honor your name for another Lord's Day. We thank you for the opportunity of worship. We thank you that we can come together, Lord, even where we are, and lift up the name of the Lord because your grace and your mercy is great and wondrous. Lord, we ask that your spirit would rest with us today as we celebrate you and lift up your name. For these things we offer our thanks and our praise, and this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Today we are so glad to celebrate this wonderful day of worship. We're glad to be in the midst of this Memorial Day weekend, and we want to honor and remember those who made and paid the ultimate sacrifice of their lives to help secure our safety and our freedom. We praise God for their service, for their lives, and for their sacrifice. And we ask that God would rest with their families as we cherish their memories. We're thankful that as we are going through and coming through this coronavirus season, as buildings and businesses, churches, entities are starting to reopen, we continue to pray God's protection, his presence, and his power. In the midst of all of what is going on, not only in the United States, but also around the world, that God would help to stay the spread of this coronavirus. So we pray that you're continuing to do the necessary and the safe things of social distancing, making sure that you are sheltering in place as best you can. Make sure that you're exercising safe sanitation practices, washing your hands and wearing your masks to do the right thing to help avoid the spread and the contraction of this virus. We're glad today that we can celebrate God in all of his glory and all of his majesty. And part of our worship is we render our tithes and our offerings to a gracious and all-loving God. Even though churches have closed and even though some churches are starting to reopen, ministry still goes on. We still need to spread the word of God, and we still need to minister to the needs of people in our community. So we honor this time as we render our tithes and our offerings to the Lord. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, again, we celebrate your glory, your majesty, and your power. Lord, we lift up now the tithes and the offerings that will be rendered from your people unto thee. Lord, as we bring our tithes to the storehouse, use them for kingdom purpose. We pray that you would bless every effort, bless every heart, and everyone who has the desire to give, and maybe right now they may not have the resource, but Lord, we pray that you would bless their heart's desire just as well. For these things, we offer you our thanks, our praise, and we ask it all now in Jesus' name, amen. Remember that you can give several different ways. You can give through the Givelify app, which you can download to your device and then follow the prompts. You can also go to givelify.com. Look for Spirit of New Ministries, and when you find that tab, then you can follow the prompts to assist you in your giving. And then you can also go to the spiritofnewministries.com website, And there on the website, if you go to the donations tab, if you click on that tab, it will take you to the green Givelify tab, and then you can follow the prompts from there. Once again, we thank you for your offerings, your tithes, your sacrificial gifts for the kingdom of God and all that's necessary. We are thankful for the word of God this morning, and I want to invite you to join me as we go to the book of Isaiah, the Old Testament prophet of Isaiah, the 40th chapter, and we're going to look this morning at verses 27 through 31. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 27 through 31, and we're going to consider the English Standard Version, the ESV, this morning. And as you're turning your pages and as you are securing your devices and setting them to that reference, that scripture passage, we're going to look at the 40th chapter of Isaiah, and again, going to verses 27 through 31. And it reads as follows. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint nor grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Last week, beloved, I spoke to you from the first 11 verses of the same 40th chapter of Isaiah. I told you that we live in perilous times. And it is human nature, part of the human condition, that when we're living through perilous times, we want a quick release from the bondage of these times. We want a fast fix, a hurried healing, and an expeditious exit from our trial, our turmoil, and our trouble. But as you well know, things in this life don't often come as quickly as we like. Sometimes we just have to wait. Because as we all well know, God can bring some good things out of bad times. As expressed in Romans, the 8th chapter, the 28th verse says, and we know that all things work together for good to those that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. I also expressed last week that we can't escape, nor can we avoid perilous times. We can't avoid them, we can't sidestep them, and we certainly cannot opt out of them. But the truth is that God never promised that we wouldn't have trying times or difficult days in our lives. But he did, however, promise that when we go through these seasons of sadness, that he would not leave us nor forsake us, for he promised to be with us always, even until the end. And that's good news, saints. I told you last week how God's chosen people, the Israelites, after experiencing the despair of multiple enslavements to the Egyptians, the Assyrians, and then to the Babylonians, were trying to navigate their way through the dark times of their checkered history. How God utilized these periods of captivity as a chastening tool toward the Israelites for their sins of unbelief and disobedience. I told you how God will also chasten us as his beloved children to help bring us back into compliance with his kingdom purpose and agenda for our lives. Sometimes, even in the midst of our perilous and trying times, we still need to be comforted. We need to just wait on God and for his power to show up. And that's what brings us now to our passage this morning, as we considered those first 11 passages of this 40th chapter, they're definitely related, and I want to take you through them. But as we looked at those first 11 chapters of this same 40th verse, what we found on last week was that God still declared comfort to his people then as he still does today. And even in the midst of a volatile stock market and historic unemployment and even raging pandemic that goes not only through this country but all around the world, Isaiah heralded to the Jews, as God says today, he said in that first verse of this 40th chapter, he says, "Comfort, comfort ye my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity has been pardoned, and that she has received from the Lord's hand double for her sins. A voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, every mountain and hill made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice cries and said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all is beauty like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. And I told you last week how, based upon this passage, that because of Israel's pardon and because of their release, the will of their captors is as grass and it blows away. And so when you look at this passage, it just really shows us that God never forgets his people in light of what they may be going through, in light of their trial, in light of their sad season, and in light of the difficult times that they're experiencing. When you continue with that 40th chapter of Isaiah, when you look at the 8th verse, it says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Go up on the high mountain, O Zion, herald a good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald the good news. Lift it up and fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before his arms. He will carry them, he will tend to his flock like a shepherd, and he will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom, and gently lead those that are with young. God will restore his people. And all we have to do is just wait for the deliverance that is on our way. And so I wanted to just kind of recap that for a moment, because now that leads us in to our passage for the morning, verses 27 through 31 of this same 40th chapter of Isaiah. And once again, God is using the prophet Isaiah to remind the Israelites of his power, his presence, and his glory. He says in verse 27, why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. And beloved, I want you to realize, and this is what Isaiah acknowledged back then, this is really a serious indictment toward God. You see, they had forgotten. They thought that God could not see their plight, that God had disregarded their suffering, and that basically God had forgotten about them. Have you ever felt that God doesn't see you? Have you ever felt that God was disregarding your suffering? And have you ever felt that maybe God has forgotten about you? Have you ever felt that God doesn't see you? That he's totally disregarding your suffering? That he's not considered about what you're going through? Well, I want to tell you this morning that God has not forgotten about you. Your way is not hidden from the Almighty, because he knows all about you. He knows all about you because he loves you. He knows all about you because he made you, he formed and fashioned you, and he's always right there with you. You see, David said something about this in the 139th Psalm. He said, you have searched me, Lord, for your thoughts, because you know me.
You know when I sit and you know when I rise. You perceive my thoughts afar off. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me and your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my innermost beings. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. And the King James says, they are marvelous are your works, and I know that full well. You see, David goes on and he reiterates the same sentiment in the 23rd Psalm when he declares, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul, and he leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest before me a table in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You see, during our plight, our suffering seasons, and our perilous times, God has not forgotten about us. We tend to really forget about God, especially when our suffering and peril is of our own making with our own circumstances, as was the case with the Israelites. Well, Pastor, what do you mean that my sufferings and my perils are of my own making? Well, the truth of the matter is some of you all are not going to like me after I say this, but when you consider Jeremiah, the 29th chapter, and you look at verse 11, it declares, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to hurt you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. What God is saying is that I want to bless you. I want to grow you. I want to elevate you. I want to help you. I want to expand you, and I want to prosper you. And see, that's just like that prayer of Jabez that you see in 1 Chronicles in the 4th chapter, where it says that Jabez, that he was the one who prayed to God of Israel. And he said, oh, that you would bless me and expand my territory. Please be with me in all that I do and keep me from trouble and pain. And notice what it says toward the end of that verse. It says, and God granted him his request. As I said, God wants to bless you. He wants to bless your plans. He wants to plan to expand your territories. But like many of us, just like the Israelites, we want to be blessed, but we want to do it our way. We don't want to follow God's prescription for our blessings. We would rather do things our own way and in our own time and for our own reasons. We would rather do these as opposed to obeying God and rendering ourselves to his word. Then when things don't happen the way that we expect or in the time frame that we want, then we want to justify making bad choices to try to get to a good place, or we then justify trying to do a wrong thing or a series of wrong things and expect to get a right outcome. I told you you weren't going to like this. But see, what God is telling us oftentimes to go right, we often want to go left. When God is trying to tell us to wait, oftentimes we don't want to wait and we just want to rush in and do our own things. Then when we get off script with God's word, our disobedience comes back and bites us right in the you know what. And so there again, when things don't work out the way we want, we find ourselves like the Israelites in our suffering season, our time of peril, and what we tend to want to do is we then want to blame God. You see, we start to say things like, well, God must not see me, or he must not know what I'm going through. My way is hidden from the Lord, and he's disregarding my situation. He really doesn't care what I'm going through, and then he's really not even answering my prayers. He's turned his back on me. If God really loved me, then why is he putting me through all this pain and suffering? But see, we have to understand that God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. And it's just like I told you last week. When we don't learn the lesson that God is trying to teach us, we have to take the class over. So now, in addressing their complaint, in verse 28, Isaiah does several things, and he does them simultaneously. What he does is that he reproves them. He disagrees with them. He challenges them by correcting them. He re-educates them by telling them. And he reminds them by questioning them. Notice what he says. In verse 28, he says, have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord, the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not faint, nor does he grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Isaiah is in essence telling them, and he's really asking them some questions. He's asking them, have you forgot your history, Israel? Have you not read the law? Have you not checked the Torah? Have you not perused the Pentateuch? Has your daddy not told you? Has your mama not revealed to you? Have your ancestors not shared with you? My God, your God, and our God, there is no shame in his game. There's no weakness in his works. There's no lack in his love. And there's no problem with his power. After all of what God has done for you, do you not remember how God blessed you, how God has kept you, how God has provided for you during times of trial and tribulation? Have you forgotten how God took you out of Egypt, how he cared for you while you were there, and how he protected you during the Passover? Do you not remember how God delivered you from the hands of the Egyptians, how God killed Pharaoh and his warriors while taking you safely through the Red Sea, and how he allowed you to cross over the Jordan River after you crossed through the plains of Moab and he delivered you to the Promised Land? Do you not remember how God delivered you out of the hands of the Assyrians? Do you not remember how God blessed you time and time and time again? Isaiah was trying to get them to understand that our God is eternal. He is the creator, the sustainer. He's the justifier. He's the edifier. He is the sanctifier. He is the encourager. He is the inspirer. And he is the one who is the provider and the savior of all humanity. He is our God. He is everlasting. And this everlasting God is the God who says he was always there. He's always there now. And he will always be there, even until the very ends of the age. And that's why he told Moses that I am that I am. This God, Isaiah was trying to get them to understand, he's the God who sees all, he hears all, and he understands all. And he's never, ever caught by surprise. He's the God who is omniscient. He is all-powerful. He's the God who is omnipresent. He's all-powerful. He's omniscient means he knows everything. And he's omnipresent, which means that he is everywhere at the same time. You see, beloved, sometimes we need a reminder. And we need this reminder to help us remember where God has brought us from and where God has brought us through. Sometimes we need a reminder to remind us how God has provided for us and how God has protected us. We need a reminder to help us remember how God has saved us and how he surrendered his love and his kindness to us. We need to remember how God takes care of us and how he keeps us from day to day, how he loves us and how he comforts us. And even in the midst of what we go through, he's the God who is always right there, even when we feel his presence or not. And Isaiah reminded them, and just as he reminded them, he encourages us today that we serve an awesome God, great and greatly to be praised is he. Isaiah goes from talking about who God is to telling them to what God does. In verse 29, he says he gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary. Young men shall utterly fall exhausted. In all of our times of our lives, there's times when we go through different seasons, we go through different periods, and there's times when we may feel faint, we may feel weak, we may feel vulnerable or powerless. There's times when we feel frail and fragile, fearless and stressed, and sometimes we feel strained. There's times when we lack energy, strength, and encouragement. There's times when we lack insight and might. But praise be to God that he gives power. And the word for power is the word in the Hebrew, it's koach. And koach means vigor, strength, ability, capacity, and force to be or to accomplish what is absolutely necessary. And really, when you think about this word, koach, it's that word that is similar to the word in the New Testament, where the disciples on the day of Pentecost, where they received power in the book of Acts. That word that says dunamis, that dunamis power that says they received the ability, they received the capacity, they received the vitality to be witnesses and to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so now Isaiah, he now goes on to say that even the benefits of being young, young bodies, young muscles, young bones, young minds, young ideas, all of these things that seem to attach themselves to young people, even these things seem to fall short. They wear out. They'll fail. Sooner or later, even the resources of young people will cease. They will eventually tire. And Isaiah says that they're going to faint and they're going to be weary. And the vitality of young men will eventually become exhausted. Youth eventually get tired, and young men will eventually wear out. But Isaiah does declare in that 31st verse, he says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And when you look at this word wait, wait in other words, means to trust in. Wait means to depend on. It means to look to, and it means to rely on. Wait means to rest upon. To wait means to believe in. Wait means to have that same faith that Abraham, the God of Abraham, gives to Isaac and to Jacob, that says that you are the God who is able to do all things, and that no matter what we go through, that deliverance is on the way. Faith that the Hebrew writer said is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. Faith that declares that without it, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. All I'm saying, saints, is that you've got to have faith. And that faith is how we wait on God. Isaiah says, if you just wait on the Lord, and not on an unemployment check, not on a stimulus check from the government, not on a cure for the virus, because we don't know when that's going to come. Just wait, not even on a word from the president that says that we need to open the country. All of these things are fleeting, but we need to wait on the Lord, because Isaiah says he'll renew our strength, and that we'll be able to mount up. And that mount up in the Hebrew is the word Allah. And what that means is to go up or to ascend above your circumstances, to be able to rise above or to go above and to excel and to have superiority, where God will equip and empower you to think, operate, and to live at a higher level in spite of your circumstances. And beloved, when you think about it, it's really like on this kind of a situation where, like on a cloudy day, let's say you get on an airplane, you're getting ready to go somewhere, and it's an overcast day, it's dreary, the clouds are hanging low. But then when you get on the plane starts to taxi onto the runway. And then when you start to take off, or in other words, when you allow, when you start to ascend up, you start to go up. and you start to go toward, and then you go through the clouds. Then you're going through the clouds and you might experience what's called some turbulence. You might have some bumps every now and away, just like we do in life. But then after you've gone through the turbulence and the pilot comes on and says, we're now cruising at about 30,000 feet. Now the plane levels out. And before you were in the clouds, now you're above the clouds and the turbulence starts to stop. And then once you've gotten above the clouds and the turbulence starts to stop, you're now seeing nothing but sunshine and blue skies, and now you have smooth sailing all the way. And that's what this is all like, because he says those in verse 31 that wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And beloved, that's good news, because when you think about it, what Isaiah is saying is that through God and in God and with God, you can do all things. You can mount up with wings like eagles. You can run and not be weary. You can walk and not faint. Somebody might ask the question, well, Pastor, what is the deal with these eagle wings, and how can I use these eagle wings, and what do they mean to me? Well, when you're able to assume and have these eagle wings, when you take on these wings like eagles that allow us to soar, in other words, you'll be able to rise above. Like I said a few moments ago, you'll be able to Allah. You'll be able to go up and ascend. You'll be able to go over and rise above the fear, the anxiety, and the frustration of your circumstances. Yes, your circumstances might be what they are. You might not be able to change them, but you know what a gracious and all-loving God can do? God can cause you to Allah. He can allow you to take on those eagle wings. He can allow you to rise above the frustration, the anger, and the fear of your circumstances. He may or may not change the circumstances, but what God will do is he'll change you in the midst of those circumstances. And what that means is you'll be equipped, you'll be empowered, you'll be strengthened to be able to think and to operate and to live at a higher level in the midst of your circumstances. God will start to settle your spirit, and he'll allow to give you a release and recognize that your deliverance is on the way. God can settle your spirit and let you realize that even though the day is dark and even though you're going through a difficult time, as the Bible says, trouble doesn't last always, and that your day of deliverance is on the way. And all of this can happen once you've entered into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Isaiah said, Israel and Jacob, why are you saying that your way is hidden? Why are you saying that the Lord disregards your circumstances? Recognize that God does not disregard your circumstances, and your way is not hidden from the Lord. God knows you, he made you, he formed and fashioned you, and he loves you. And God just wants you to wait and realize that he's going to show up and he's going to show out. That you, all you have to do is wait and know that God and his deliverance are on the way. Know that God will open doors that are closed, and he'll close some doors that may be open. That our God, when you wait on him, that he's the God who's able to mend broken bodies, broken relationships, and broken lives. That God we serve, if we just wait on him, he's able to change our hearts, our minds, and our situation. All you have to do is just wait, just wait, just wait, because our deliverance is on the way. Beloved, we serve a great and an awesome God. And his word says that it's not our place to try to change a thing, but it's our place to just wait on him. And when we wait on him, our change will come. We are thankful today that we serve a God who says to us, just wait on me. I know your circumstances. I know your situation. And I'm the God who will bring about a change when it doesn't look like a change is going to come. Beloved, if you want to be in that place where you can have that relationship with an all-wise, all-knowing, ever-present, and all-powerful God, all you have to do is ask him to come into your life as Lord and Savior. If you remember, God says through his word that he loves the world and that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe on him would not perish, but would have life everlasting. If you want to have that everlasting life, it's available for you today. You don't have to wait for another day or another time. You don't have to wait till churches come back together or reconvene, but you can have that relationship right now. All you have to do is just repeat these words in this prayer. And this prayer declares that we know and we acknowledge that God is the one who provides our salvation, and through him, everlasting life is provided. And if you want to receive Jesus Christ today, just repeat these words after me. Father, I know that I have sinned. Please forgive me. I want to turn away from those sins. I believe that your Son, Jesus Christ, died for my sins. He was resurrected from the dead. He is alive right now, and he is hearing my prayer. Lord Jesus, I invite you to become the Lord of my life, to rule and to reign in my heart from this day forward. Lord, please send your Holy Spirit to help me right now to do your will today and for the rest of my life. I pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed this prayer, know that an all-loving God, Lord Jesus Christ, has just stepped right into your heart. So, beloved, be encouraged, stand strong, hold to the unchanging hand of God, and continue to look to the hills from whence cometh your help. I pray that you have a blessed Memorial Day weekend. Be safe, stay strong, and be encouraged. And may God bless you, and we'll see you next time.